الحمد لله رب العالمين، اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. الحمد لله. We want to welcome you to the Muslim Center of Greater Princeton. This is your first time here. We want to again welcome you, and we appreciate your presence. Those of you who have made this your masjid home or have come before, we appreciate your continued presence and support for our programs. Alhamdulillah, keep us in your prayers. We are honored to have a special visiting scholar today, Imam Allama Sheikh Fode Fuad Drame, who's visiting us all the way from Vancouver, Canada, on the West Coast. And he has been in the Princeton area since Friday, alhamdulillah. Teaching first and giving khutbah at NBIC, the New Brunswick Islamic Center. And then on Saturday, he had a number of private engagements. And then today, he's chosen and honored us with teaching after Fajr this morning, teaching before Dhuhr at the Garden of Knowledge Academy, and then teaching now again, being very generous with his knowledge and generous with his time. Each time, we've been learning new things. And inshallah, just a few things about the Imam. His bio, if you want to read an extended biography, is on the website of the organization he started several years ago, the Zawiya Foundation. That link is zawiyah.ca. zawiyah.ca. If you go to that website, you will find links and lots of content to his audios, video lectures, to his works. He has a magazine, Al-Qalam, that's published every quarter, I think, every quarter. He has retreats, at least three or four retreats every year. He teaches Tafsir of Quran in a way that is accessible to everyone at every level, whether you know Arabic or whether you are a scholar of Arabic, whether you've never read Quran in your life in any language, or whether you've been studying Tafsir for your whole life and teaching Tafsir for your whole life. He teaches Tafsir in a way that everyone can connect with Allah through the Book of Allah. He does that every Sunday afternoon, Pacific time, and every Wednesday evening, Pacific time. Those classes are live streamed. Again, if you go to the website, zawiyah.ca, you'll find all this information. As I was saying after Salat al-Dhuhr, after meeting Imam Fode, I really understood the meaning of the hadith, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنُ وَعَلَّمَهُ. The best of you is the one who learns, internalizes the Qur'an, embodies the Qur'an, and then teaches it to others. And, you know, this is his mission. It's to connect Muslims and humanity to the message, to the light, to the guidance of the Quran. He's very active in interfaith work in Vancouver, among many other projects. He has a school, the Khalsain Knowledge House. They just also launched an online academy, the Khalsain Higher Education Institute. And he has many, many important projects. And so without any further ado, I can go on talking about the Sheikh. He knows he's literate in 10 languages. He's written about 200 books in Arabic. He has books outside, Tafsir Surat Yasin. And he's been just a tremendous blessing to me and my family as a brother and as a friend as well. So I'm very happy to introduce him to you. The topic we'll be discussing is faith and reason. Today's topic will be faith and reason. Jazakallah khair. Thank you for coming.
Assalamu alaikum. Alhamdulillah, wahidun minan. Wassalatu wassalam ala sahib sunan. سيدنا وحبيبنا وشفيعنا قدوتنا محمد سيد القلوب ودوائها وعافية الأبدان وشفائها نور الأبصار. أوليائها وعلى آله الكرام وعلى صحابته المغابير ومن اهتدى بهديه واتبع سنته وما هجته البيضاء الحمراء إلى يوم الدين والجزاء وبعض. The topic today is of a paramount importance. The relationship between faith and reason. Because understanding that relationship determines the kind of education we devise for our children. And it is not a matter of choice. You have to choose between faith and reason. It's a matter of order and sequence. Which of the two comes first? Both of them are very important, indispensable to be a good believer, indispensable. So it is not a question of which one is better or which one do you choose. No, both of them are necessary. As I said, what matters is to know how do they relate, these two. Or how are they ordered? Which one comes before and which one comes after? So that's what we're going to talk about. Because Quran does mention both of them, and in praiseworthy terms, it talks very highly about the intellect or reason, and talks about faith, which is an intuitive acknowledgement of something that's not based on rationalization. Even though this common mistake has lingered across the history of humanity, that these two are irreconcilable. People have talked about, philosophers have talked about over the ages, that reason and faith cannot be reconciled. There's no harmony between them. It's either this or that. And to the extent that even some Muslim scholars have bought into that idea that these two are irreconcilable. Quran talks about them in various places and gives us the order between them. There's a hadith that Prophet ﷺ said when he came for Hajj, he said he came to Safa and Marwa, and he said, "I will start where God started." Abda' min haythu bada' Allah. Meaning what the Quran says, which one Quran mentions first? Inna Safa wal Marwa min sha'a'irillah. That doesn't mean that Safa is better than Marwa, Marwa is better than Safa. But I started where God started. So the same thing we do with Quran, where whatever God starts, we know that that's supposed to come first. It's not a matter of, as I said, being selective, predilection. It's a matter of following an order, following a system. So in the Quran, God talks about hearing and understanding, which is the word for aql. Sometimes these words are replaced by other words, but the same reality. It talks about iman and knowledge. But it means the same thing. Because knowledge, the instrument for knowledge is the intellect, reason. Let's go in Surah Al-Mulk, which most of us probably know by heart. When those who are going to Jannah, I establish in Jannah, and those who are going to Jahannam, I establish in Jahannam. The guardians of Jahannam asked the people who end up there, they said, did a warner not come to you? They said, yes. And they said, قَالُوا لَوْ كُنَا نَسْمَعُ أَوْ نَعَقِلْ مَا كُنَّا فِي أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ لَوْ كُنَّا نَسْمَعُ أَوْ نَعَقِلْ مَا كُنَّا فِي أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ فَاعْتَرَفُوا بِذَنْبِهِ رَسُولُهُمْ لِأَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ. They said, had we listened, had we heard, so they began with hearing, or understood, meaning they used their reason, then surely we will not end up in the hellfire. If you don't use them, these faculties, then you are heading for destruction. God gave them to us so that they can be means for us to know truth from falsehood, and therefore choose truth over falsehood. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه. Allah, show us the truth as truth and give us tawfiq to follow it. And show us falsehood as falsehood and keep us away from it. But seeing it is that the means of perception is hearing and then understanding. So these are faculties that are given to you, but it's up to you to use them. That is your role. God gives it to you, you use them. For those who don't use them, it's as though they never have them. In Surah 2 Al-Jasiyah, God says, أَفَرَعَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَٰهُ هَوَاهُ فَأَضَلَّهُ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ وَخَتَمَ نَعَ وَخَتَمَ عَلَىٰ سَمْعِهِ وَقَلْبِهِ وَجَعَلَ عَلَىٰ بَشَرِهِ غِشَاوَةً. Allah put his seal on his heart, on his hearing and his heart. Because what comes to the heart, the door for the heart is the hearing. The door for the heart is the hearing. If the door is closed, then nothing will come inside. So, وَخَتَمَ عَلَىٰ سَمْعِهِ وَقَلْبِهِ. These two are connected in the Quran all the time, hearing and heart. And understanding comes in the heart, consequently. Because Allah said, قَلَمْ يَسِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ فَتَكُونَ لَهُمْ قُلُوبٌ يَعْقِلُونَ بِهَا أَوْ آذَانٌ يَسْمَعُونَ بِهَا. We travel in the land and have a heart by which they can understand, or ears by which they can hear. So hearing is the gateway to the heart, and heart is where understanding takes place. So first thing, we need to learn to hear. So the first commandment God gave to Musa al-Salam, he said, فَاسْتَمِعْ لِمَا يُوحَى. Listen to what I'm going to tell you. Listen. فَاسْتَمِعْ. So this is the process to be a good listener. That is the way to knowledge. And to be a good listener, requires one fundamental condition, is to be somebody who is trusting, to trust, and to have faith. Meaning that, do not approach what you're listening to with a critical mind. then you will not be able to hear. You have to come just with trust and just take everything in. That's where faith, the role of faith comes in. Those who come with that trust, they hear and they believe. Those who come without that trust, those who come with a critical mind first, before listening, they don't get it. They miss the point. So first thing, you listen, you be a good listener. So now Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam, in his story in Surah 2 Al-Baqarah, when he said to God, I want you to show me how you bring the dead to life. رَبِّ أَرْنِي كَيْفَ تُحِي الْمَوْتَى. And God said, أَوَلَمْ تُؤْمِن. Do you not believe? Meaning that what I said to you, that I'm the one who gives life and death, don't you believe that? أَوَلَمْ تُؤْمِن. He said, yes, bala, I believe. وَلَكِنْ لِيَطْمَئِنَّ قَلْبِ. But I want to understand. I believe, but I want to understand. That's what reason is. I want to know it rationally. I want to see how the breakdown. That's what we call reason. Because reason breaks things down into their individual components. You see clear. He said, no, I believe that you have the qudra, you have the power to bring life to death. But how do you do it? How it is done? This is the question. That's what reason is about. How does it happen? The method, the steps, reason is about. Faith is about looking at it in a synthetic way, and reason analyzes. So faith synthesizes, reason analyzes. But you cannot analyze until you synthesize first. You put it together first, and then you break it down into individual components. So we call that aggregation and segregation. Al-jama' al-farq, in the common Islamic terms. Al-jama' al-farq. And the word furqan. Furqan is the knowledge, reason. So al-jama' first to put it together, to look at something as a whole, as one. It's what iman is about, to have a global look at something. Then reason is about looking at things individually. So kind of it analyzes things and breaks them down into their individual components. So as a method, you cannot analyze before you synthesize. That doesn't work. So you can't put reason before faith. If you do that, you are on the wrong, you are on the wrong path. And that's why many philosophers use their mind, their entire life, they could not get to the truth. Because the method is wrong. You cannot put reason before faith. That will lead you to darkness, a dead end. It doesn't work. If you start your way from faith to reason, then you have faith, and you have reason both, but in Toulouse, you are Muslims, you can be a believer and a philosopher at the same time, a believer and a scientist at the same time, as long as you follow this order properly. You go from aggregation, then the segregation. First you look at things as a bulk, as one. And then you look at them in terms of particulars. That's what faith is about, and that's where reason starts. So we are admonished to nurture both faith and reason, but in these secrets. So that's the difference between our system and the other systems. So in another ayah in Surah 2, Yunus, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا كَانَ لِنَفْسٍ أَن تُؤْمِنَ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ وَيَجْعَلُ اللَّهُ الرِّجْسَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ. It is not fitting for a soul to believe except by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thus Allah puts shame on those who have no aql, who don't use their reason. In Surah Al-An'am, is the other way. وَكَذَلِكَ يَجْعَلَ اللَّهُ الرِّجْسَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Thus Allah puts shame on people who do not believe. And these two, Iman and Aql in the Quran, which is Iman and knowledge, because Allah says, وَتِلِكَ الْأَمْثَالُ نَضْرِبُهَا لِلنَّاسِ وَمَا يَعْقِلُهَا إِلَّا الْعَالِمُونَ. Those examples we give people, but only those who know understand. Why we said, so it's either Iman and Ilm or Samu and Aql. And both of them are always, because in Quran, the word reason does not exist in a noun form. It's always in a verb form. Meaning that it's a continuous process. You have to keep on thinking. You have to keep on reasoning. It's not an entity. It's a reality. An ongoing process. Always, ya'qilun, ya'qilun. There's no word aql as a noun in the Quran. Okay? And similarly, we have iman also comes always in the form of a verb. In a progressive tense, la yu'minu, la yu'minu, la yu'ya'ladina amanu, aminu, or you who believe, believe, and still continue to cultivate belief. Because it's not a one time thing, as I said this morning, that your faith is always challenged. So there has to be a continuous expansion and growth in your faith and in your reason. So these are the two major pillars of religion. Religion functions both on Iman or Samu, hearing, and Aql and Ilm. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لِيَلِينِي ذَوْ الْحُلُومُ مِنْكُمْ. Let people of understanding among you stand behind me. I mean the first rakah. People who, when the imam makes a mistake, they are able to fix it. That one who needs to be in the first line. Rasulullah says, so this for us to give respect to the intellect. So Islam is not against reason. As sometimes people are made to believe. Islam champions reason, but only on this condition, that reason is not placed before faith. That reason does not come before hearing. As long as we respect this order, then reason finds its rightful place in our religion. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in Surah 2 Al Imran, where he talks about the the creation of the heavens and the earth. He says, إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ Ayah 191, I think, beginning. لَآيَاتٍ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ In the creation of the heavens and the earth, and the alternation between day and night, are signs for people who have an understanding. الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم ويتفكرون في خلق السماوات والأرض ربنا ما خلقت هذا باطلا سبحانك فقنا عذاب النار And they remember Allah standing, sitting and lying down and they reflect and ponder. So this is the process of Aql. How do we move from Iman to Aql? That's the process. How do we make our children be thinkers? Cultivate the desire to know, because this is their purpose in life. To know. From one level to another. The first level of knowing is to know Allah through His creation. How did Allah create this earth and this heaven? That's the first thing. So we call that, it's called fikr. So the first level, fikr, then from fikr you come to fikr. You think on reflection or meditation. So remember first, يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ وَيَتَفَكَّرُونَ The second step toward understanding or knowledge is fikr. يَتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَوَاتِ They reflect upon the creation of the heaven and the earth. And upon their own creation. You ponder and reflect. You have to instigate this desire in your children to know. And sometimes we repress this desire in them when they keep on asking too many questions. We say, too many questions, don't ask me anymore. This is very, very bad. Asking questions is the first step to knowledge. A child who has a lot of questions is a very good child. If you encourage him, he'll be an alim one day, somebody who knows. And the hadith says, "Kun aliman aw muta'alliman aw sa'il." Be alim, somebody who knows already. Aw muta'allim, somebody who is seeking knowledge. Aw sa'il, somebody who asks questions. وَلَا تَكُنْ رَابِحًا فَتَحْكِكْ But don't be the fourth one. Otherwise you are lost. You are neither these three, you are nothing. Either you ask questions, inquire, or you are seeking knowledge, or you already know. Only these three categories of people are useful. Their life has a meaning. Be one or the other. At least be among those who ask questions. Through asking questions, you receive knowledge. That's why they asked Ibn Abbas, how did he get all this knowledge? Somebody asked him, قَالَ بِلِسَانٍ سَعُولٍ وَقَلْبٍ أَقُولٍ بِمَا نِلْتَ هَذَا الْعِلْمِ بِلِسَانٍ سَعُولٍ وَقَلْبٍ أَقُولٍ He said, I got this knowledge by a tongue that asked so many questions, and a heart that's able to understand. لسان سؤول وقلب عقول. It was what أقل. Another hadith about this. الدنيا ملعونة وملعون ما فيها إلا ذكر الله وما ولاه وعالما ومتعلما. Then everything in dunya is deprived of blessings, except three things: remembrance of Allah, or anything in that guise, or aliman, somebody who has knowledge, or muta'alliman, and somebody receiving knowledge. Then Allah said, "Fas'alu ahla dhikri in kuntum," ask people of dhikr if you don't know. And that Allah has taken a covenant with people who know to teach, and people who don't know to ask. So if you don't know, Allah has a covenant with you. Your covenant is that Allah says to ask if you don't know. Those who know, to teach. Yeah. If you don't ask, ignorance is no excuse in the sight of Allah. You can come to Allah, "I don't know." That doesn't pass. If you don't know, why didn't you ask? And I said, "Fas'alu ahla dhikri in kuntum la ta'lamun." Ask people of dhikr if you don't know. So it's my excuse. If you know and don't teach either, that's also even worse. "Man katama ilman aljamahu Allahu bi ijamin min ghayr al-qiyamah." If you hide knowledge, Allah will put a rain of fire in your mouth for keeping quiet and not saying it. So the alim and the jahil, this one is job is to ask, this one is job is to teach. So second step towards knowledge, meaning that how do you develop somebody's rationality, ability to analyze and understand. First one, dhikr. Without dhikr, nothing goes. Second one is fikr. Fikr. It's about the curiosity to think and reflect. And that requires something very important, silence. The longer you stay silent, the keener your ability of fikr becomes strong. Silence is very good. It enhances your power to reflect. It's a buildup of energy within your heart. Call that fikr. So once you have learned to do fikr constantly, then you go to the next level. That level is called nazar. Nazar, observation. You remember, you reflect, you observe. And Quran, subhanAllah, our book is excellent. It talks about all these methods. We just need to internalize them and apply them. It works. It's been working ever since. If you apply it, it's going to work for you too. It's universal. So dhikr, fikr, nadhar. Nadhar is to observe. So one leads you to the other. Without dhikr, you can't get the fikr. Without fikr, you can't get the nadhar. So once you get to nadhar, become an observer. Observe everything around, below you, above you, ahead of you, behind you. Allah gives us an ayah in Surah Al-A'raf. It says, "أَوْلَمْ يَتَفَكَّرُوا مَا بِصَاحِبِهِمْ مِنْ جِنَّةٍ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا نَظِيرٌ مُبِينٌ أَوْلَمْ يَتَفَكَّرُوا Have they not reflected that their companion is not a madman? Have they not observed?" So after fikr, it was about nadhar. "Alam yandur fi malakuti samawati wal ard," in the inner kingdom of heaven, malakut. So fikr leads you to malakut. Malakut is the inner side of and everything has a malakut. So when we talk about malakut, we only think about heaven and earth. But everything has an inner dimension, that's the malakut. That's why the ayah says, أَوَلَمْ يَنْظُرُوا فِي مَلَكُوتِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. And everything Allah has created as well. Look into their malakut. If you do, you will find Allah's oneness. Even in a small insect, as a bee, as an ant, reflect upon them and observe them. In them, we find Allah's oneness. So that's nazar. Then from nazar, we go into basar. See. And there's a very certain nuance between nazar and basar. As you can see. Use the word nazar also to look. Anzur. Qul anzur. Say look, observe. Mada fi samawati wa ard. What is in the heavens and the earth? But basar. Does everybody who look see? No? No. Just looking doesn't mean that seeing. It's two different things. So seeing is a different level. We can look, but we may not see. How many things are here around us here that we don't see, even though we are looking? We are looking at them, angels and other things, and other beings that are present in this mosque. And jinns, shaitans. So everybody looks, but not everybody sees. That's all in Surah Al-A'raf. وتراهم ينظرون إليك وهم لا يبصرون. You see them looking at you, but they do not see. The seeing is attainment. لا تدركه الأبصار. Sight do not attain him. So that's the where the entire realization happens when you can attain with your sight. Then that's the end of the spectrum. We have come to certainty, yaqeen. Because yaqeen is by seeing. And that's where the full understanding takes place. Knowledge comes at the level of yaqeen. As you know, ilmu al-yaqeen, aynu al-yaqeen, haqq al-yaqeen. Yaqeen. Yaqeen comes by seeing. If you don't see, you have no certainty. You do, I can have faith, but certainty only comes with seeing. That's why Sayyidina Ibrahim said, I want to see how you bring the dead to life. I believe it. I haven't seen it. And of course, the common mistake that they said, seeing is believing, is that true? Of course not. If you see, then you don't need believing anymore. You believe without seeing. Yeah. Seeing without believing, that's true. But seeing is believing, not true. Once you see, now you are certain. You have yaqeen now. Now you know, that's what we said. You have knowledge now. By seeing it. And that is the end of the spectrum. So this is Islamic methodology of pursuing knowledge and attaining certainty. And only certainty will bring total satisfaction to your heart. As in my Quran says, وَلَكِنْ لِيَتُمَ إِنَّ قَلْبِ. I want my heart to be fully at rest. By seeing, by knowing. So this is the story of faith and reason. Just to put it simply, that we have time for questions, answers. In our book, Quran al-Kareem, that runs methodology for pursuing knowledge. Inshallah, hopefully we can start working on these steps from dhikr to fikr, from fikr to nazar, from nazar to basar, and basar, yaqeen, certainty. And that is the Father's goal that every seeker is looking for, to find yaqeen. Allah said, وَكَذَلِكَ نُرِي إِبْرَاهِيمِ مَلَكُوتَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَلِيَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُوقِنِينَ. Allah said, we show Ibrahim in the kingdom of the heavens and the earth so that he may have yaqeen. And he did have yaqeen when Allah showed him how life and death come out of one another. At that point, وَعَلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. Know that Allah is almighty, all wise. InshaAllah. If you have any questions, then we'll come to the
questions.
He's asking about the ayah in Surah Al-Isra. Allah says, Inna al-sam'a wal-basara wal-fu'ada kullu ulaika kana anhu mas'ula. Meaning that Allah says, hearing and sight and understanding, you have to be accountable for all of that. We'll ask you, what did you do with your hearing? What did you do with your sight? What did you do with your heart or with your understanding? Yeah. So as you can see, the ayah uses three things, sama and not ulum. Is that hearing, but not ears. So not the physical instrument. That's not what matters. That's just an organ. It's about the basar, but not the ayn. Sight, but not eyes. So you're responsible for your hearing, you're responsible for your sight, about eyes. Because these are the energies or the faculties that are located in these places. And the third one is fu'ad. Fu'ad is the power that is lodged in the qalb. So qalb is the instrument, fu'ad is the faculty. It's the faculty. The understanding that it arises out of the heart is called fu'ad. That also is some confuse fu'ad and qalb. Some say this qalb, fu'ad is the organ, qalb no, is the other way around. Because in according to this ayah, fu'ad is the power that is in the heart. Basar is the power that is in the eyes. Sam'a is the power that is in the hearing. So when the body dies, these entities live on. They live on. Your basar, your fu'ad, your sam'a move on to akhirah. And the day of judgment, they come to witness for you against you. Allah said, يَوْمَ تَشْهَدُ عَلَيْهِمْ سَمْعُهُمْ وَأَبْصَارُهُمْ وَجُلُودُهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. The day when their hearing and sight and their heart or their fu'ad will come and witness about what they have done. So you're going to account for what you do with these powers God has given you. You are meant to use them to please Allah and not to disobey them, disobey him with them. So you have to account for what you hear, how you use your hearing, not your ears, how you use your sight and how you use your understanding. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, human beings are naturally inclined to things that do good for them. If you do good to someone, it's going to incline to you. That's just the human nature. Jumla bil nufus ala hubbi man ahsana ilayha. The human souls are naturally inclined to one who does good to them. But inshallah, it helps to create some kind of motivation for people to listen. Tell them the benefit of what they're going to hear. Because when you talk about benefits, they are keen to hear what they have to say. That's why God, before He told Sayyidina Musa His duties, first thing He told him something that will rouse his interest. He said, I have chosen you. I didn't tell him what the responsibility is I chose you. He said, not good. Do this, I have chosen you. No, I have chosen you first. Oh, I'm chosen now. I'm selected. Let me hear the rest. No, this is the rest. So inshallah, the way of them opening up, and being keen to hear. Whatever it is, inshallah. Yeah, is there a point where faith leaves reason? If so, at what point? The question is, can be answered maybe depending on what it means. Yes, there are points when they part company, they're supposed to part company. One of those points when you are about to die. At this point, reason should not be present. That's over now. Your reason is useful to you until that point. When death comes, you only go with faith. What does the hadith say about the dua of the mayyit? Allahumma man ahyaytahu minna fa ahyihi 'ala al-islam wa man tawaffaytahu minna fa tawaffahu 'ala al-iman. Allah, whoever you give us life among us, let them live on Islam. Islam is aqal. And when those who to death among us, let them die on iman. So when iman comes, there's no more calculation. You totally just rely on Allah's rahmah. Don't count on your good deeds anymore. That's very dangerous, something like that. Because that brings some sort of pride in your heart. If you die with pride, you can't enter Jannah. And there is a story of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, rahmatullahi alayhi. When he was on his deathbed, and his family, because he prepared himself, he took his shower, he dressed, and he laid on his bed, waiting for Allah's decision. And his family sat around him. At some point, he lost consciousness. And his sons are telling him, Okay, Baba said, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. And he was telling them that not yet. La ba'd. And they keep on. Sometimes people are very insecure. That's not good. When you asking Mike, somebody who's dying to make kalima, don't force them. Maybe they're already saying it internally, you don't know. So when Junaid was dying, somebody tell him, say the shahada. He said, I never forgot it. Why should I remember it? I've never forgotten it anyway. So they are telling him, Baba say la ilaha illallah. She said, no, not yet. And they kind of getting frustrated. You know, here is a man who lived all his life serving knowledge, the deen, and he's not even saying shahada. So at some point he regained his consciousness. He came back. And they asked him, they said, Father, we are telling you to say kalima, you're saying not yet. When are you going to say it? It's now. He said, my sons, I was not talking to you. I was talking to Shaitan. He was standing here. And he was telling me, oh, Ahmad, finally you escaped me, finally out of my hand. I told him, not yet. Because when he was trying to do was to puff him up. Oh yes, finally I conquered Shaitan. That is dangerous. Never do that, especially at the time of the night. So he wants him to feel proud. Died with pride and never make it to him. He said, not yet, because I'm still here, I'm still breathing, you know. It's not over, my fight and you, it's not over. Only the last breath, that is all. So at that point, reason put aside. Just put your entire trust in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
What is the relationship between Ibn Yaqeen, and Hafiz Yaqeen? The second question is, what is the relationship of, I've heard you speak about Tadabbur. What is the relationship between Tadabbur and
Mabla, Fikr, Fikr, Fasal? So Tadabbur relates to the last part of Yaqeen, which is Haqqul Yaqeen. That's called Tadabbur. Haqqul Yaqeen. But Yaqeen itself, as he just mentioned, is in the three categories. The two categories, Ayn al-Yaqeen and Ilm al-Yaqeen, falls under the two categories of Allah's qualities, Adama and Kibriya. So Yaqeen about Adama is called Ayn al-Yaqeen. That's to know the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Adama is about the beauty, the Jamal. So those are qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So ilm al-yaqeen is about Allah's kibriya, Allah's majesty. To have yaqeen about Allah's majesty is called ilm al-yaqeen. To have yaqeen about Allah's jamal, or his azama, his magnificence, is called ayn al-yaqeen. The word ayn azal means beauty. So now these are the two qualities of Allah, or the two dresses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as in the hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Allah says, Al-Azamatu Izal, Wal-Kibriyaru Ridai, Faman naza'ani fihima, Qasamtuhu wa la ubali. Allah says, Azama, magnificence, is my mantle. Kibriya, grandeur, ridai, is my overcoat, something like that. فَمَنْ نَزَعَنِي بِهِمَا If you contend with me in this, I'll crush you, and I don't care. So keep away from Adama and Kibriya. Now whatever beyond that, is fine. So these are the two qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in terms of categories. So when we said dress, that's why I said dress, a dress is a quality. When you dress in a certain dress, it gives you a certain kind of look. That's what the sifat of Allah, yeah, His dresses, in which He appears to His creation. But they are still different from His essence. Because this is my dress and this is me. So the dress covers the essence. The same thing Allah's sifat covers his that. And through them that is manifested. But that manifestation is covered by the kind of dress that he's wearing. If he wants to come to you with Jamal, he comes to you in a different dress. If he appears to you with Jalal, he comes in a different dress. But those who know him, whichever way he comes, they are okay. They know how to. But those who don't know him, they only know him one way. Like the hadith about the Day of Judgment. So, that on the Day of Judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appears to the congregation. But he appears with lots of majesty. You know, in a language that is very hard. And says, make sujood. So the believers who knew him only through his beauty, they said, no, this doesn't look like our Lord. They're used to him talking to them this way. Is there no going to bother? It is not one that will let me know. If he comes, you will know him. But the people who are complete in their ma'rifah, they know his name, whichever way he comes. Then he comes back in a form that they are used to. Comes gently with them. They feel his rahmah, his gentleness. They say, yeah, this is our Lord. And they make sure. So, you can know him either. You can know him through his jamal or jalal, adam or kibriya. But knowing him through both of them is the most complete home.
Somebody else? Yeah, go ahead.
Well, some people who check in reason these days are not really philosophers, they're really scientists. As you know, Thomas Kraus, Roger Penrose.
Yes.
They're really scientists.
Yes.
And they are, you know, people believe them as people who are philosophers. And many people have many philosophers have argued that they're really believers. They just don't believe in God.
Yes.
That's their belief. How do you, in today's scientific world, how do you tell average people that these are really believers? They just believe that there's no God, there's no reason they think.
Yeah, even I think that is actually in the scientific process, there's something that they call hypothesis. That's the beginning of all scientific discoveries. You make a hypothesis. And hypothesis is not something that is a proof. It's just you speculate that if this thing happened this way, this might be the result. So there is a level of faith even in that process. So scientific discovery happen, don't take place right away. It kind of builds into something. So that initial state is faith. It's an intuition that a scientist gets. Maybe if I do this and this, this might happen. You don't know this at the beginning. So that's called a hypothesis. A hypothesis is iman. It's something that is something unknown. It's not known yet. Iman is what? To believe in the unknown. To believe in immediate possibilities. That's what iman is about. So even scientifically speaking, there has to be some measure of faith for you to be able to pursue a scientific research. So definitely it is. It is still part of science. And they, even though they deny religion in the end, but they do have, they have no way of going around that. Without faith, human being can't even survive. You can't even live. Because there's no absolute certainty in science either. There's no certainty. Science doesn't talk about certainty. Because how many scientific discoveries
today are disproved again in next generation. So there's no certainty. Certainty can only come through knowing God. So yeah, sure. Definitely, this is a proof that science has so much of failure. If you know, they don't speak about it.
Is there a particular zikr or a name of Allah that you can use to help you develop that inner understanding, inner knowledge, or inner sight?
Yes. So zikr also goes according to the names of Allah. So you start with the name of Rububiyyah, the name that relates to Allah as the Rabb. Like Al-Bari, Al-Khaliq, these are names of Rububiyyah. Something that category you start with that. And then you can move from that to a name that has to do with Allah as a Malik or Malik. Al-Malik, Al-Quddus, Al-Salam. In that, so in end of Surah Al-Hashr, you see how they are categorized? Wallahu alladhi la ilaha illahu, Wallahu al-Malik al-Quddus, Wallahu al-Khaliq. This is the category. First one is Uluhiyah, that. Second one is Mulk. Third one is Uluhiyah. Yeah. So you go according to that, in an ascending form. Naam.
I want you to comment on this. I think one of the, I think it was called, I'm pretty sure. There's a person who came to him and asked him that I've tried every which way, within reason, time frame. I come close, but I cannot. Wait. So Al-Ghazali thought about it and he said, you've tried everything, the only thing I have to say is this. And I think many of us have gone through this or may go through it. But that's what I'm doing. And when he said something to disappear, that if you've tried everything, all I can tell you is, bow down by the Son of the Rasulullah. Do his zikr and beg from him that the Rasulullah. I am the reincarnation to whatever you have made, but my wisdom is still finite. Your wisdom is infinite. Please accept. And as a beautiful saying, so I just want to see what you have tried for reasons of any which way, but you somehow don't get to that point. This is a question answered by one of the scholars, I think, was Al Ghazali, who said, finally, you've tried everything. Mm-hmm. All I can tell you is go into Sijda and beg and say, that's what I'm telling you, you are the infinite voice. I have just been
prisoner
standing in my head.
He said,
so maybe that's something
that... Absolutely, no, I will definitely
write
about that.
I wanted to comment on it,
but yeah, it's about... It's about going back. Because if you can go forward, Don't waste your time trying to push the bomb. You cannot push any further. So if you can go forward, then you go back. So sajda is an act of going back. Because the earth we come from, you only go back to God the way you came from. You came back from the earth. You want to go back to Him, you go back to the earth. It's the significance of making sujood. If it makes you, you connect again with your origin, with the soil, with the dust. And that's the time when you are closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that brings that tenderness from Allah that He had for you when He molded you from dust and from clay and water. That's why I said to Iblis, you refuse to bow down to the one I have made with my hands. Because when I make this with a machine, and I made it with my hand, which one do you think I'll be more attached to? The one that I made it, because I have touched it. Touching is very important. That direct, you know, contact between us and Allah was through the soil and the water. Because He made our water and soil with His hand. And that is the compassion of that. When a human being goes back to his fitrah, Allah has mercy. So there is another hadith about the angels. That they came to Allah, they said to Allah,
You know, you created the human beings. They sleep, we don't sleep. They eat, we don't eat. They have intimate pleasures, we don't have intimate pleasures. So Allah has made all this for them. Leave us also Jannah.
Allah said to them, I will not make one I made with my hands like the one I said, be and it is.
That process of making with the hand is a unique aspect of the human being. That's what Allah loves us. As long as we are in our fitrah, as long as, except that we are nothing but dust.
So, I have.
So, sister, no, you can ask the questions. You want to write? You can write, and you're welcome to ask as well. So just take two more questions. I'll give preference to the sisters if they have any questions.
Yes, in Allah khalaqa Adam, and in Rahman khalaqa Adam ala suratihi wa andashu, that Ar-Rahman created Adam in his image. Of course, it's not a physical image. He made Adam with his hands, and he used both his hands, both his attributes. Have been united in the human being, his attributes of majesty and beauty, all together. So in other beings, it is either this or that. Only in the human being, everything is combined. Allah's qualities. So our only purpose in life is to be able to best reflect those attributes that Allah has already placed in us and be a mirror in which the rest of creation can see the reflection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that is the entire purpose of the deen, to become the better reflection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you can take any of his attributes and make and work on it. Let's say his attribute is al-haq. Make that as your attribute. Be truthful in everything that you do. No matter the consequences, be truthful. And you will see that's going to be your way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Oh, sabr is sabr. This is how you can walk your way towards embodying the qualities and the names and the purpose of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have lots of questions? Alaykum as-salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that light will clarify the issue for you, you will see your way again. At this point, reason comes back again. But at that point, when nothing is working, it's nothing but faith. Just let go. So not only at the time of death, but any time that looks like that. But when you have death means what? You have to surrender. You have no choice. Let go. The same thing we come to that point in our life, pay off.
We ask that Allah reward Shaykhuna Fode abundantly. That Allah Ta'ala protect his family, protect his community in Vancouver, and all of those that are connected with him in the seen and the unseen. Thank you so much, Shaykh, for your time and your generosity. We thank all of you as well for coming and being present, and your patience. Everything that, or much of what Imam Fode just discussed, the past hour, is in his latest book, Expansions 6, Volume 6, The Book of Knowledge. The Book of Knowledge is being sold outside. It goes into more detail, and perhaps some of you would like to make a commitment to read it, and we can invite Imam back at another time where we can read it and discuss it with him. This is a breakthrough in the epistemology of Islam. It is like nothing that's ever been written. And I don't know if you understand how weighty that is. It is like nothing that's ever been written by a Muslim scholar. And we are really honored and blessed by Allah to be in the presence of an original scholar, an original thinker. Alhamdulillah. I just want to recognize a few people in the audience. Chaplain Patricia Anton from University of Penn, University of Pennsylvania. We want to recognize her. Imam Qaisu Aslam, who's from Rutgers University. Dr. Abdurrahman Abt, as is here in the front row. He will be leading us in the Rumi Circle this Wednesday. So those of you who love Maulana Jalaluddin Rumi, if you love spirituality and poetry, and talking about really deep issues, please come back this Wednesday at 7:30 p.m. inshallah for the Rumi Circle. More details are outside of the flat screen. I want to recognize his son, Amr Abdurrahman, who is a world authority on Islamic finance. We're very honored to have him in our community. And Sheikh Hasib Abdurrahman is also here from the Zubaydah Foundation, and a representative of Imam Talib Abdul Rashid from the Mosque of Islamic Brotherhood, the historical masjid founded by one of the students of Malcolm X in Harlem, New York. Imam Talib wanted to be here, but he couldn't make it. And of course, our beloved Imam Rasul Suluki, we want to recognize him as well for coming all the way up here. Jazakumullah khairan to each and every one of you for your presence. And your continued support. We want to let everyone know that tomorrow at 4:30, Princeton Muslim Life with Imam Suhaib Sultan will be hosting a lecture with Imam Fode at Princeton University. Will that be in the Office of Religious Affairs? Does anyone know? Where? Cartsfield? Okay. Go to their website, Cartsfield, inshallah ta'ala. Pardon me? Okay, we'll be in Richardson Auditorium at 7:30 p.m. Richardson Auditorium, I'm sorry, 4:30 p.m. inshallah. Richardson Auditorium. Jazakallah khair. Thank you so much. You asked that you close with the dua. Alhamdulillah.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa sallim taslima. اللهم اشرح بالصلاة عليه صدورنا ويسر بها أمورنا وفرج بها همومنا واكشف بها غمومنا واقضي بها ديوننا وأصلح بها أحوالنا وبلغ بها آمالنا وتقبل بها توبتنا وأنس بها وحشتنا وارحم بها غربتنا واجعلها نورا بين أيدينا ومن خلفنا وعن أيماننا وشمائلنا ومن فوقنا ومن تحتنا وفي حياتنا وموتنا وفي قبرنا وحشرنا ونشرنا وظلا فوق رؤوسنا يوم القيامة حتى تدخلنا مدخلا وتأوينا إلى جواره الكريم مع الذين أنعمت عليهم من النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وصحبه وبارك وسلم. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.
Just a correction, tomorrow's program at Princeton University will be at Robertson Hall at 4:30 p.m. Robertson Hall, not Richardson, Robertson Hall, inshallah. Thank you.
Yeah. years old.